everything gets recorded. So thanks for turning up. Where numbers are small, some of us are used to saying that the enthusiasm is high. So we presume that the enthusiasm to know about the subject is high. Just as when, as a teacher, I don't get a response immediately in the class, then I tell my students, I say, maybe the response is going to be deeper. It's not going to be superficial. I ask a question and then pop comes the answer. It'll be deeper. So okay, thanks for turning up. You probably have seen the email. The email says, Shri Rakesh Shukla shall be talking about the lures of fascism, agonies and delight. The usual understanding that some of us who grew up thinking about these things was that fascism is some kind of a right-wing revolution. People are energized by slogans like, from Hitler's time to yours, you know what. And the difference that they make between, the difference that exists between authoritarianism and fascism would be that authoritarianism is usually state-led. It's the cops and the army that comes knocking on your doors. Emergency was authoritarianism in India. The cops decided what you shall speak, think, etc., etc., etc. Fascism is when you can join that authoritarianism happily with crowds on the street, which will be much more enthusiastically, you know, implementing the agenda of what may be the ruling dispensation. So it's just not the knock on the door that is terrifying about fascism. What is terrifying is that you will start self-censoring yourself. You know, there'll be a self-censor built into your mind, you know, because you feel that somebody is going to come and attack you for what you think, say, do. That's one. The other is that, you know, we've been understanding for a long time that it isn't necessary for capitalism to always take the authoritarian route. It can happily survive democratically. You know, it, if, you know, selling products and making profits and continuing with this process of capital accumulation is the purpose of capitalism, then you can do it democratically as well. But then, when you have this authoritarian streak that you witness, enthusiastically supported by crowds in the street, you know, we now have, you know, Facebook and what are the other forms of social media, which is also street of a different kind on the internet. Then we used to think, you know, all this is related to some perfidious games that the rich and mighty are playing, you know, for purposes of capital accumulation. The nation is only put out as a slogan, and the essential purpose is capital accumulation. You know? People used to also say that history is being misused, and you know, these grand ideas about who we were the first, and we are, what is it? We are the first and we are the best. You know? And we've been that for thousands of years. So it isn't as if today. This has happened today, you know. So if somebody says, no, your civilization is less old than the Mediterranean civilization, people will say, what they'll say, you know. I'm being recorded, so I might as well save my breath and words. Anti-national, I think, they'll tell you. So, you know, history also gets used. But one another thing that has come as, well, not so much of a surprise, because Wilhelm Rieck has been saying that for a while, but is not being accepted, is that at least, because in his small abstract that Rakesh Shukla has sent us, he said that the Hindu psyche or the Hindu mindset, you know, in that mindset there seems to be a problem. In the sense that those who are opposing fascism, actually the problem, he says, is more with those who are opposing fascism. You know, they don't understand that you are trying to push an elephant into a foxhole. That was, I think, William Reek's catchy phrase, you know, as to how those who are opposing fascism are kind of behaving. Itta wala elephant, you're pushing it down a chota sa foxhole. Because all of us are complicit in, through whatever notions we carry of our own selves being best, ideal, you know, first, etc., etc., etc. You know, so hence several explanations can be given for there not being many people here in this room today. You know, end semester, one of our bigger semesters is gone, etc., 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 etc. But then Rakesh would like to ask, and he was asking me, what is happening in Delhi? You know, same thing, you know. So we, those who are opposing fascism also, are probably, well, shall I say, unke bhi dil mein chor hai, if Hindi is allowed, you know, unke bhi dil mein chor hai, because, you know, you are complicit in that project. You know, you actually think what they are saying, that we are the first and we are the best and, you know, everything is happening for the best reason and good fortune of all of us. I've done enough of buck. I saw my students and I couldn't hold myself. Rakesh, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Bhupinder, and hello everyone. As you can see, I have abandoned the binary of ladies and gentlemen, because this talk has a lot to do with binaries, of being in a way caught in binaries, whether of good, bad, pure, impure. Now, phenomena like fascism or militant nationalism or xenophobia, there is a complex of factors, social, cultural, economic. And what in this talk I'm trying to do, and one of the angles of viewing is the psychoanalytical. See, a lot of dispute and debate happens if we try to say, okay, this angle provides all the answers. It is not so. Each of these factors is extremely complex, and here the attempt is that this is an angle of viewing, and maybe it can be of some assistance in trying to understand the processes at play. And what has also happened is that social and political events, generally it is as if the psychological component is not thought of as relevant. A lot of people involved in working for a better society come from the communist movement. So now, Freud came about half a century after Marx. And the kind of analytical tools to understand the unconscious drives were not there when Marx was there. So in a way, one is trying to view it from this angle. And actually, after World War II, there were studies done about the authoritarian personality. And it is that something like fascism, it does not improve the situation for most of the people. That in a way, it is doesn't appeal to your rational interest. That it is in a way appealing to some emotional needs, something which is not in the ring. Even now here we see, whenever I, this is all anecdotal. If I talk to people, they'll say, yeah, demonetization all of us could see caused hardship. Or GST, I go buy something, they'll say, yeah, so-and-so from my village used to work in Ludhiana, all the small units have closed down. But in a way, the popularity doesn't. Winning of municipal elections, winning of panchayat elections, winning of state assembly elections. That in a way, one is trying to view this to understand what it is appealing to. Now one, the mail I had sent to him did say Hindu, but actually it is universal. The psyche is universal, that is what I subscribe to in human beings. So all of us have anxieties, insecurities, rage, anger, feelings of being humiliated, hurt. And on the other side, we have positive feelings. For example, for our mother, for the land in which we live, for what we inhabit, for our community. Now what, in a way, fascism does is enmeshes and utilizes both. So in that way, it is paradoxical. And the psychoanalysis frame itself is paradoxical. It's not that it just utilizes the negative in a way, that it okay mobilizes your rage and your anger, and that is not so. It also utilizes the positive feelings we have as human beings, and these are universal feelings. The third thing we need to see is the difference between what is called group behavior. Like those of you may have noticed, even if you see dogs, you'll see how a pack of dogs behave and how an individual dog behaves. So now, this is a study done long back in 1895, one of the first studies, that when you are in a crowd like that, then what happens is your feelings get, in a way, simple and exaggerated. And uncertainties and doubts vanish. And a mere suspicion immediately gets converted into a certainty. So that what are antipathies? Immediately they can go in the direction of hatred. And in that, in this group functioning, there is very little space for logic or rationality. So in this imagery, in a way of the mind, there is not much space for that. Now, when we see this about playing here, how this is playing out in India. Now, Muslims actually constitute in independent India approximately 14% actually. But this fear that we will be, Hindus will be attacked, outnumbered, and annihilated. And this kind of propaganda, it is called, Goebbels was the minister for Nazi Germany when Hitler was there. That, okay, they have four wives, they'll have 64 children. Or this played such a role that more Hindus have been killed in riots. In 2002, I had also gone, as many of us had gone to Gujarat. This played such a central role. Now, you can produce government statistics, and there is no statistics showing that more Hindus have been, not statistics by activists, Government of India statistics. But this played a central role. And that, okay, this was the first time when more Muslims were killed. That is why, at that time, Mr. Modi got this of Laha Purush, that he's the Iron Man, like for the first time this has happened. So beliefs like this, which do not have a basis in any like kind of statistics or in any kind of reality. Or this then, along with gets, for example, Genghis Khan. Now, Genghis Khan, he was actually in, I think, 1227. Now, he is perceived as a Muslim. He was actually a from this Turkish Mongol tribe, and even the religion he followed was some kind of shamanism. But even in Gujarat now, it is Genghis Khan ki aulad, means the Muslims are the progeny sired by Genghis Khan. So the other thing which he does, now this again has no basis in any, history like that, And he came to Punjab and Multan in 1221, So figures like this, Genghis Khan, Taimur, all these were Turkish Mongol. And so what is happening is, first, that happened when? Centuries back. You conflate it with present day Muslims. The present day Muslims had nothing to do with it, So first you conflate it, and then there is no denying that there are antipathies between Hindus and Muslims. Many times as progressive secularists, we seem to, this thing looks very attractive that the British divided India. But actually Hindu-Muslim antipathies were there. See, once we don't recognize it, we cannot think what to do about anything. Now, when you stoke this kind of a thing, whether it's, Genghis Khan's progeny and conflate this, then exploiting this then takes it in the other direction, as if the repositories of all evil are Muslims. Now we come to the psychoanalytical frame. So what I'm trying to do is, see, these are all concepts evolved in the context of an infant growing up and dealing with anxieties as the infant grows up, and in the context of individual therapy. And but I feel they have a lot of application to broader phenomena. And so what happens is, so what I have done is, I have taken the, these are primarily Freud himself, then after that there is a very little known psychoanalyst called Melanie Klein. She actually really developed much more in depth into the anxieties. So these anxieties which are there as a child grows up, now what are those anxieties? With babies, we do not know. So these are all in the nature of speculations, So they may be about being, who knows, devoured up, engulfed, eaten, we don't know, being annihilated. And so what happens? There are defenses. Now defenses are two mechanisms to reduce our anxiety. So one are conscious defenses. Like I may feel, okay, conscious defense is, okay, I'm feeling, let me go and do meditation. Let me go for a walk. Now here what we are going to is the unconscious defenses. So this will be considered an unconscious defense. Like a lot of time you might have heard people say ordinarily, don't be in denial. Like for example, that is one of the things where you, it's a defense to think that it never happened, So that the infant uses these mechanisms to cope with the distress and anguish felt. Now, one of the ways which the infant copes with this is, it's called splitting. So you split a thing into good and bad. You might have seen at times children saying, the doll is bad, and give it one slap. So it is that, for the child to think, I am bad, so the bad part, what the child has done, is split onto the doll. The doll is bad. So the child many times, to cope with the distress, feels, splits it into good and bad. So that carries further, I am good, my mother is good, my motherland is good. And one of the most, I think, intolerable feelings all over, in all societies, seems to be of dirtiness. That I think we find the fact of dirtiness about ourselves intolerable. so that we see it across the board. Like in Germany, the Christian Germans, the Jews were dirty. Hindus, you say Muslims are dirty. And it is across the board. Even in colonialism, you'll find that people feel the natives are dirty. So dirtiness is one of the things which I think we find most intolerable. And associated with it is notions of pure and impure. So we find that these concepts which were developed like splitting, they seem to occur in a broader way at a community level, where communities are splitting off the parts which they consider shameful, negative, dirtiness, lust in Indian society, I don't know about other societies, lust is also one emotion which seems very difficult to tolerate. And you might have seen many times, you will see even in instances of harassment, that the male who's accused will say, she was provocative. So rather than in an acknowledgement, because you consider lust is shameful, so you don't acknowledge that lust, but you split it and put it on the other person. So these are some of the emotions which I have taken from the psychoanalytical view and placed it in the, in a way, social political sphere. The third thing, one is the anxieties, then the defenses of splitting. The third is this transference. Now what this is, Freud introduced this term, transference. He found that in his, as a doctor-patient relation, that his patient had lot of whatever admiration and this, so he introduced this transference. And a lot of people feel that this transference had a lot of application outside this clinical room. People like Eric Fromm, that actually transference is happening in a wide way. Now, what exactly is transference? So it is of, in a way, looking up at someone on authority. And along with the idealization of that authority. And Freud, to a very limited extent, tried to give an example saying how the position which, say, Christ enjoys, you know, or the commander in chief may enjoy in the army. But he never really carried this transference into the wider political sphere. The person who has put it well, and he is Sudhir Kakkar, that what exactly is happening here? So what happens is, like when we see the admiration, that there is in fact a conscious, in a way, depreciation of yourself. And so which is, and you idealize the other person, which often happens also in this, he has written in the context of the Radha Swami group. It's a spiritual group of Radha Swami group. And what happens, so you idealize the guru in a way, or you idealize the Führer, and then deprecation means, I am not even fit to be the dust of your feet. So, you know, so these two go hand in hand. Now, what happens after that? But simultaneously, there is identification with that. So you also identify. So it is what, in many times we refer in common usage, as people say, oh, this is reflected glory. So in a way, you idolize the person where what you've done, you've in fact taken the positives you have and put it on the third person. You know, whether it's Maharajji, whether it's Modi ji, whether it's ABCD. So that was the process of identification. So I'm taking these three concepts from here. So this is the basic psychoanalytical frame which I will be using. Now fascism that way doesn't have any kind of uniform doctrine. Like you may say, okay, you know, communism has this and, you know. However, there are certain shared features of fascism. One is aggressive and unquestioning nationalism. And there's one person I had heard, she put it very well. It's like one nation, one flag, one language, like everything. So it is this sort of nationalism. Then it is the belief in supremacy of either one nation, ethnic, or religious group over others. Third, it is a disrespect for democratic institutions, even as they are used in power. Some of you may be aware that actually the Nazi Party came into power in 1932 through elections. And even when we look at the elections here in 2002, at that time, so see, like the chief election commissioner, these are democratic institutions. So when he suggested postponement, it is like saying, oh, he's a Christian, you know? So while you use these powers, but there is disrespect in these institutions. And it has an insistence on obedience to a powerful and absolute leader, along with a strong association with militarism. And it has what is called a demagogic approach, like appeals and whips up emotions. So like that crowd which we saw earlier, so that emotions are easily swayed. You are like carried away in a way by your own militancy, you know. Now these are the shared features of what were called, these are organizations in various places. These were called black shirts in Britain. Then Mussolini's party was their Partito Nazionale Fascista, Iron Guards in Romania, similarly in France. So when we see this, and now we look at RSS. Now this was formed in 1925. And its agenda has been to transform a kind of pluralistic liberal Hinduism into aggressive Hindutva. Until today, they say we're a cultural organization. It is not that their aim is to run the government or to come in power in the government. Their agenda is different, you know. So it was formed in 1925, then various things, the family grew. So you had the Rashtriya Sevika Samiti for women, the ABVP for students, Bharatiya Mazdoor Sangh for workers. Now when we look at the structure, it's a rigid hierarchical structure where leaders are appointed rather than elected, and at the top is the Sar Sangh Chalak, means he's the supreme commander at the top. And it is open to married men, however the grihast, the householder, he has a lower footing. And the ideal is the virile but celibate son of Bharat Mata, which is embodied in the Pracharak. That is the model of followed. And Govalkar, who in 1939 had said, we or our nation defined, he had actually great appreciation for Nazi ideology and substituted the desired Hindu nation for the valorized German nation. And in fact, till today it remains the same. That's a weakening Hindu race. Symbols of Hindu pride are being attacked. Ram temple is attacked, Ram Setu is attacked. So this has been a constant kind of strategy and refrain, you know. And Savarkar himself was an atheist. And he used actually religion totally in an instrumentalist way. Like even when his wife died, he refused, there were protests, any Hindu rituals. So I mean, it was a person who used his religion to forge what he felt this was the best instrument to forge what he wanted for India. And at that time, these were not present times. He died actually a very disillusioned person because actually his organization or party never got much of a footing here, you know. So we may be speaking of here, and I feel in every, see what happened after World War II, it almost looked as if fascism means only Germans, Japanese, or Italians. Actually, fascism is in every society. And I myself feel like just as there are some people who subscribe to capitalism, communism, there are a section of people who subscribe to fascism. And I feel if it was confined to, say, groups like Bajrang Dal, RSS, Hindu Vahini, or individuals like Singhal, Tugadia, I would not feel such a threat. I feel in every society there are people who subscribe to this ideology. But when a sizable section, like in Gujarat we saw, it's like 20,000-25,000 people. And it seemed with a predominant approval at that time of the Hindu community, you know. And we see the results that if you succeed in polarizing society along these lines, then you can ensure an electoral win by the Hindu majority vote. Three successive elections have been won. So, I mean, in a way, the electoral victory is a byproduct of the polarization. Then we come to what Bhupinder to some extent referred to. Now, what happens is if we construct this as, okay, these are dirty fascists in a way. Now, that will not take us anywhere. If we don't see the support, if it was confined, so to say, to dirty fascists, and that's the way we see it. And this seems a very difficult process. This William Reich, who was there, he recognized that a large section of the working class actually supported fascism. Now, unless we recognize this, I don't see how we can go further. Because unless we understand why people are attracted to it, there is, little question of trying to see what we can do about it. So what he wrote at that time on what he refers to as the psyche of the common man or little man. And he drew some interconnections between daily life, sexuality, family, workplace, and the growth of fascism. So that, I feel, is in a way relevant here in what is playing out. So here when it was mentioned about the Hindu psyche, what I'm saying is, we are here. I come from a Hindu family. So it is a universal thing. There are aspects in the psyche of every society. So it is not to in any way single out and feel that here. So we are best placed to understand the aspects in the psyche here with Meshen. I mean, today it is no longer confined here. Even in Austria, I think it is almost close to 50% the right-wing party there. So I'm saying every society has to reflect and see. So we are reflecting on here because we are here. So here I've tried to take this framework of trying to understand the psyche of a sort of common and try to see how it is playing out here. Now in that, one is the question of sex and intimacy. And so we see the nature of husband-wife relations. And also in these things, see, there has been much change in India. But, you know, there's much change, we may change of appearance, the outer change we can see. But how far there are changes in the emotional structure, these are much slower. So I'm saying India does seem to be changing drastically. But how far those structures of our inner world have changed, that is not clear. But it is likely that they are much slower. So when we look at sex and intimacy, now we find more or less, we look at both. Arranged marriages, where the persons may be almost perfect strangers. And also that setting, if we look at it, it is again a very unequal setting, that the girl side is weaker in a way, or it is, you know, it is almost a culture in many places to, in a way, humiliate them or make caustic comments about them. So those are the kind of beginnings. And now, consent is very much center stage now, whether in the Farooqi's case or in so many cases. And now, so now in that whole setting, how much of a role, what is the consent as far as the bride is concerned? Until today, marital rape is not recognized as a offense. Now it is there, somebody has challenged it, and let us see where it goes. So these are in a way the very stark beginnings of conjugal relations in India. Now, you know, the clinics of psychotherapists, I practice law and also practice psychotherapy, and I do couples therapy also. They're actually full, many of women who are either depressed or disillusioned after marriage. And Kakkar, so these has done research of many even lower caste working women. So it's not just middle and upper class women who may come to psychotherapy clinics. And what he writes is, it's a shame-laden affair, a sharp stabbing of lust with little love and even less passion. And the expressions which he uses, which the women, it's like saying, I get it done once a week, you know? Then we come, when I'm saying the outer structure is saying, so we now, then we have love marriages. But whether it has made how much of a dent, so you will find that, okay, this is a realization of somebody who were a romantic couple for 7 years. Then it says the man goes with the day before the marriage with his mother and demands a dowry of 50,000. And when that's not given, he throws the girl over and she dies. Now, in this sort of a setting, what happens is that the emotional center of the woman many times is children, especially the son. And now this displacement, in a way, of the woman's sexual longings is very difficult for a growing boy to handle. The anxieties, we can only speculate, of either engulfment, they become acute. Psychoanalysts apart, you would see, the men especially, if you've been ever in a public toilet in the north, the traditional healers, what they apply to, they have the male anxieties of the Indian, North Indian male totally taped, you know? Anxieties about performance, anxieties about potency, all these. So, and in the therapy you find that many women say that if they're openly assertive, they feel that they are unconsciously perceived by their husband as powerful mothers. So on one side we have this sex and intimacy. Second is the selfless sons. Now Bhishma Pitama story you know. So Bhishma Pitama, the Indian myths, none of them are like Oedipus. The Oedipus story is hostility to father. While if you see Bhishma Pitama, it is that he gives up. His father wanted to marry a boat woman who said, my children will inherit the kingdom, so your son should not get married, so he willingly gave it up. Similarly, other myths like King Yayati, he was cursed of old age when youth. So he asked his sons, elder sons don't agree, youngest son agrees to give up his youth and to his father. So all the Indian myths are like this. There is no Oedipal myth like that to be found here, you know, where you willingly give up political and sexual potency. Also, we find there is no room for ambivalence. I don't know how many you've heard, but this is a very common story of Shravan Kumar related in the north. So his parents want to do a pilgrimage. So he puts them both on his shoulder, one in one, and for years he's taking them all around. And there is not a trace of resentment in the thing, that there is no ambivalence permitted at all in any in the relation. Then we have Bollywood. Everybody knows that dialogue from Deewar. Tere paas kya, mere paas maa hai. You know, the two brother dispute. And it is not only Bollywood. When I say that inner structures change very little. Now this was a film which I saw in the International Festival for Gender and Sex. This is made by two young male directors. And it's called All About Our Mothers. So they had interviewed their mothers. So it did raise issues of, you know, housework, double burden, but all within the husband-wife paradigm. And as far as the mother-son relation is concerned, the sons have made mothers the heroines of the film, and the mothers have helped the son in making the film. So there wasn't, it doesn't touch anything at all upon this, the mother-son relation. So, and in fact, what impact it has, because even in my work as a therapist, this is one of the features which really contributes to a lot of marital misery. I work as a therapist in the Delhi High Court Mediation and Reconciliation Center. This relation with mother. So a boy brought up on tales like this. There's a tale called, which I heard myself as a child, that okay, there is conflict between wife and mother. The wife says, go cut the heart of your mother and bring it. So the man goes, cuts the heart of his mother and brings it. And while bringing it, he stumbles. And the heart says, beta chot to nahi aayi. Son, I hope you didn't get hurt. And you see, when you use the Hindi, actually the effect comes much more in the... see, these are the stories a boy has grown up on, you know. So this is the... And so Kakkar is the first one where he feels what he terms as the maternal enthrallment. He feels that unlike the Oedipal myth, where okay, hostility to father, here the son needs an alliance with father to actually individuate from the mother. That it is not, that all societies are not the same. And the founder here, Giren Shankar Bose, also, he had actually European patients and Indian patients, and he disagreed with Freud. But more or less, that frame has been taken, that here things are, it may be the other way around, that the son may require actually an alliance with father, you know, in order to be able to individuate and separate from his mother. The third factor in this constellation is valorizing of celibacy. As we saw, RSS also, that okay, the brahmachari son, the celibate son, is the model. Now this is such a, it's a really strong belief, and it cuts across class. That this loss of strength in the falling of the seed, so to say, and that even Bhishma Pitama himself, because he's a brahmachari, he had this boon he got of death at will, that you can even win death. And we see in wrestling, see what happens, many aspects we can see better in when we see them in a slightly extreme spectrum. So you see wrestlers, their whole philosophy is to abstain, build up stock, and as if semen as the physical, and as almost like a moral and physical sort of repository of everything, you know. So that has been this valorizing of, now we look, see these aspects, and we see an adolescent growing up. So now an adolescent boy growing up, there's no acceptable outlet for pent-up sexual drives. Now this, all these beliefs of weakness, it blocks up healthy masturbation too. And even when indulged, it has guilt, anxieties, and fears. On the other hand, we see in almost all Indian languages the abuses which are there. Mother F, sister F, all these are abuses. Even sometimes you'll find people pulling up people and say, you mother F, you don't have mothers and sisters in your house. And it in a way encapsulates the feelings. And so what happens with this, that the boy's own, so to say, unbrotherly feelings for the virgin sister, the non-son-like feelings for the mother, these again evoke guilt. Now this, when it's combined with, say, sexual fantasies, I mean, the incest taboo is there, there would be no need of a taboo if there wasn't an attraction, you know. So all these then lead to feelings of frustration, guilt, and a perversion. And when we see in the public domain, I remember in 2007 CBSE, I mean, there's no more respectable a body than the Central Board of Secondary Education, it tried to introduce adolescent educational program. There was such an outrage, it was banned in Maharashtra, one of our most industrialized states, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, and Rajasthan. And a total denial of sex as un-Indian, and as a plot by Western countries to introduce sex and spoil the younger generation. And this is not even anecdotal evidence. I have colleagues like mine who themselves felt this, you know. So whether it's the, what their anxiety is, so in the public, and while, and simultaneously, what do we find? Again, there's a Government of India survey, some 50% child sexual abuse in India. And I think boys almost 50% of child sexual abuse. So here is this. And so these are all in the nature of speculations. There are feelings of how they might possibly, feelings of guilt, anxieties, perversions, how they might get mobilized. And this is again in the context of what we saw earlier as splitting as a defense. Like when I feel intolerable, if I feel being dirty, I feel it's so intolerable that I split it. And I say, I am pure, Bhupinder is dirty. You know, what I said, what a child does at a doll, you know. So what we have, so this is a kind of a mixed bag of the male psyche. Extreme suppression of sex, mother-son relation bond powerful, and along with it, we have this image of decapitating Kali, who's dancing nude with a garland of skulls. So mother is also fearsome. Yes, mother says chotani hai, but there is also a fearsome mother. This I'm saying in the context of the anxieties it may arouse, of being engulfed, or the anxieties which are aroused in the boy. And along with the son giving up potency. Now here we come back to William Reich. Now his basic postulation is that suppression of sexuality leads to repression within the psyche. He feels that economic distress leads to rebellion, but he feels sexual distress prevents rebellion. So this is his basic postulate which he's drawn, that this moral inhibition of the child's natural sexuality, which last stage is impairment of genital sexuality, it makes the child afraid, shy, fearful of authority, good and docile, what I was referring to as soon as we entered the room, Bhupinder, good and docile in the authoritarian sense of the word, and that it affects critical faculty. Now, when we say we are speaking of India, so it is not like singling out India or singling out some Hindu male psyche. There is no doubt all psyches, including there's a psyche in the of any Muslim psyche. So this is, these are universal aspects, and we have to, because at times whenever I have spoken, people seem to think as if I am singling out. See, the greatest manifestation of fascism was in Germany, not in India, you know. And even today, India is not Germany of the 30s. You know, so it is not that. So we are here because we're trying to see what to do about our society and the society we live in and the land we live in, you know. Now, with this mixed bag of psyche, we have the education system. And this Lord Macaulay said that the education system is designed to actually produce clerks. Now, what it has led to is, you know, we have this mixed bag already of the psyche, you know, anxieties about not getting employment, single-track education system, family pressure to marry, produce grandchildren, fulfill duties towards parents. And it seems to leave very little space to develop interests and healthy enjoyments. So on the one hand, we have a kind of what could be said as a non-assertive personality, who gets maybe pushed around the workplace, who's an obedient son. But this also has a converse side, where he may be an authoritarian father, an authoritarian husband. He may say, okay, you must serve, obey me, serve my parents well. And that whether this side of it gets somewhere enmeshed and mobilized by fascism, the converse side of this mixed bag of psyche and these situation where in life there may not have been much space to develop healthy interests and enjoyments. So now No, I'm trying to hurry it up so that we have some time for discussion. So we have feelings of inadequacy, lack of potency, and there are a lot of fears about potency, marriage, even all these posters which I was talking about. Now, along with it, what comes is looking upon the other community, males, as superhumanly virile, potent, and lusting after our mothers and sisters. Now, this is true across the board. When we see the white supremacist ideology, the black males are looked upon as virile. Similarly, Jews were looked upon. And similarly, I myself in 2002, and this is a common belief, that Muslim men are virile. So this is, along with it comes this opposite side of it. And how this is used, actually long before 2002 happened, the women's bodies, they were used throughout. And in public meetings, speeches, pamphlets, schools, ashrams, it is in a way spreading venom and demonizing that they despoil our women. The place we went where about 25,000, his name is Dilsukh Maharaj, he's a runs an ashram. He mobilized some 25,000 people and attacked this village because what happened is that mostly Muslims rushed to where they were in larger numbers. So this was a village, there were 40% Muslims, but not a single house remained. And the cry was really this, they despoil our women. And when you see after the 2002 train incident in which the car sevaks were traveling, if you see the Gujarati papers there, it is that Hindu women were abducted, raped, killed, so many were kidnapped, and particularly is that, okay, women were found with their breast cut off. Now, using all this in a way, see, the breast is looked upon as a nurturing breast. So these are all that, in a way, it is your mother taken away, and it evokes this kind of infantile rage. Now, all this got mobilized. So what happens? You build upon Hindu-Muslim antipathies which are there. You feed into the insecurities. You stoke fears. And this kind of a successful implanting of the belief that the Hindu community is under threat. Now, this in turn, what it leads to is a, you know, crossing of a certain threshold and a kind of othering of the other community. And in this, what also helps is what is called the whore and the goddess divide. So what happens? That the Muslim male or the male of other community, like since this is happening across the board, whether it's between black and white or that they are lusting after our mothers and sisters. And this along with conflation of Genghis Khan, Babur, Taimur, and you know stories of looting, plundering, and rape. And this then makes almost sexual violence against Muslim girls and women as a righteous act to save the honor of our mothers and sisters. And also simultaneously, in a way, it emasculates the men of the other community. And as far as the killing of the men is concerned, this othering means they are looked upon as almost like some beast-like animal creatures. So it is like as if you are killing some, you know, non-human person, you know. Now, when we see this in the context of where it started, the span I had given was about 25 years, you know. Now, this is another psychoanalyst. He studied a lot of conflict. His name is Vamik Volkan. And this is like a formula which he has used in the context of Serbia and Croatia. Like, what do? You pick a chosen trauma from history. Now, Somnath, Mahmud Ghazni, I think, came in 10,025. You know? So you. Now, in the case of Serbia, this was some battle of Kosovo in 1396, which was used in the 90s to whip up nationalism and an ethnic cleansing of Muslims. And at that time, this Ottoman Empire was there. So like the same thing like India is like conflating that attack with present day Muslims, you know. So you invoke this past trauma and the anger and rage which is generated. Then you turn it to this sort of agenda, you know. And what I would like to conclude with is that I feel there are certain areas of exploration which can offer us insights and understandings of what are the processes at play, and they can help us in devising strategies as to how to engage with this. So one is this idealization of mother with no ambivalence, extreme suppression of sexuality, the revering of brahmacharya, celibacy, giving up of potency for father, a desire for charismatic father. What happens in this transference is that in a way you're obviated. When we live life, we have dilemmas, we have to make decisions. Somebody else makes the decisions. You don't have to take moral responsibility. I say he is bad, go and kill him, I take responsibility. So this desire for this kind of charismatic father, Führer, so it obviates the need actually for autonomous functioning and responsibility. And actually, life is mostly shades of gray, and so the difficulties of grappling with that. So the world is turned into good, bad, dirty, pure. And so I feel explorations in this area could offer us insights as what we could do. The one suggestion which I did have is see what happens. In individual therapy, what we are trying to do is to take back responsibility for one's projections. Now, what we need to do is to have some form of a kind of a therapy where at a community level, at a collective level, because I don't see community relations improving if one community is not going to acknowledge or take responsibility, acknowledge its dirtiness, acknowledge, okay, these are dirty aspects of myself. If all the time what is going to happen is that it's going to be split and projected on the other community, then it is difficult to visualize how community relations will improve. So I think we need to devise some processes where at a collective level, the community takes responsibility for one's projection. And I said that I started off with binaries. It's then integration of the good and bad within us. So I feel one of the processes which could happen is, which I am very myself keen to explore this possibility. Thank you. And now it's open. It's not question and answers really. I have always disliked this school classroom format. But many times people have to then disguise their critiques and comments and in the form of a question. So I think people, it's open. Anybody who wants to say anything.
Fundamental question. Do you think that there is such a thing as the supremacist feeling amongst the proselytizing evangelical Abrahamic ethos? Is there a supremacist ascendem? The chosen few versus the non-chosen few, is there a supremacist thought process, in your opinion? Various people have written about it, but I'd like to know yours. Secondly, in that, isn't there a feeling of the us and the others, and that we must subdue the others? Another thing you had mentioned is this Kosovo incident, 1365 versus 20 whatever, isn't there a psyche in which this exists, like the public memory, that we, the conquerors, had it so good then, now it's all frittered away. And finally, you mentioned about the psyche that is there, the one you were explaining, the father figure and the mother, the Devi versus all that. Haven't we extrapolated the Abrahamic thought process into our psyche and discarded our inherited legacy of the earlier psyche, which did not have all this sort of this supremacist and us versus them thing?
We take it one at a time. I did not jot down. So one is, I'm not very clear from what I understood, but my understanding is that in each, this kind of supremacist feeling, is there in each society, there is a section which believes this.
I'm talking not of the feeling in societies, I'm talking of conceptual, doctrinal ethos which exists, which is different from you and me and individual, anecdotal, some good people, some bad people, and some bad society is good. That's all different. We are talking of conceptual, we are going to go by a constitution. When you discuss a thing, you can't discuss some passing faces or societies or anecdotal, you and me. You got to decide on what the conceptual, doctrinal tenets and commandments say. And then...
Well, I'm afraid this is not really my area. I'm not a competent person to answer this. Huh? I have chosen a different area to engage with. So, law and psychology primarily, so.
So, what are the conditions that make one community have this, or is it a battle of on both sides, but because of certain contextual conditions, one is a dominant story to tell?
Yeah, that is what I think. Like, I may be talking here of the Hindu psyche, but I have no doubt that the two feed into each other. That in the Muslim psyche also there is an exactly similar psyche. To some extent, I think he may have been referring to say that, oh, maybe we were conquerors and we were superior. Or so now here I'm considering it's also to do with what one is focusing on. One is whether the majoritarian is more dangerous, which is what I feel today. And the second is, I myself have grown up, I come from a Hindu family. And I feel it comes better, I'm more familiar with the texture of growing up in a Hindu family in North India. I'm more familiar with the emotional texture, more familiar with the stories a boy is brought up with, you know. And that, so I'm able to speak better. And so it is not to sort of put one over the other. I feel, yes, it would be really good for someone to explore the myths. I'm not really familiar with the myths and stories in a Muslim family. But I'm sure the constellations might be similar as far as, but I mean, that is speculation. I do not have any particular, I mean, without having some experience as a therapist or some sort of study about it. But that is my hunch. But that is exactly, so it is not that I feel each society, that is why I feel it is actually universal, you know. And we can see it today, that there are certain, everyone is most surprised at Trump's victory in US, and I mean, people used to say that, oh, the Democrats want him as a candidate because then they will never win, But this is one thing which I'm very keen on, some sort of collective process which we can devise.
My question is, you have spoke about when a child grows up, what is his psyche, okay? How his or her psyche develops, and how he or she thinks. So from the very starting of childhood, when a child started to understand things, there is these is that you are of fascism that you are talking right, I mean, talking about. So, you're also a counselor, and you do all these things to sort out these things. So, Of course, we can't avoid fascism. It is kind of become a habitus within us. So is there any way, is there something that we can balance out? Because the seeds of fascism is very well, you know, in our culture and everything. So is there any way out? Is there any?
See, one of the things which I see, I mean, I totally agree with you. And Foucault has written once, no? Yes, there is a fascism of Hitler and Mussolini, but here I am, this is in a foreword to a book called Anti-Oedipus. But here I'm talking about the fascism within each of us. Now, my process of training as a therapist is I've been going myself for, psychoanalysis is a field where you have to go for your own analysis, to be able to see these things in yourself. Now, when you're talking of the fascism within us, to some extent, Bhupinder also referred, which we can see most often in, for example, intimate relations, in marital relations. We want 100% agreement. If our partner or spouse disagrees with one, it leads to such rage. I mean, if you want 100% agreement with somebody, it is some fascism within us to want that, you know? So if we can see these aspects, as I'm saying, that what therapy has done is to initiate a process of acknowledging one's bad parts, one's parts which it considers dirty or shameful, to acknowledge them. And I feel that it has remained confined here, and these concepts have been developed in the context of the client therapy relation. But actually one can see that this happens even at a broader community level, that community as a whole are splitting parts. Because, and dirtiness looks one of the really universal things which seem very intolerable, that the dirtiness you have to split and put on somebody else. So now obviously individual therapy is individual and it cannot be done, I mean, we can't have some crores of therapists. That is why I am very keen if we can have some process which is, you know, of a collective taking back at a community level of, you know, rather than splitting as the parts which we consider too intolerable and putting it and projecting it to the other, to take responsibility for one's own projections. So that is what it enmeshes in. That's why I said, okay, people may subscribe to something, but unless it enmeshes within, it will not have such widespread support. And I feel that this lack of engagement, first of all, for all progressive people, it is extremely difficult to acknowledge that ordinary people, a sizable section supports fascism. Now this itself is the first block. Acknowledgement is the first step in any problem, you know. And what William Reich also said, even the German Communist Party after that, it said, no, there was fear psychosis. I mean, fear psychosis, all these are just terms. So the first step itself, when you don't take, to first recognize it, that there is sizable support, then we can try and see, like, what is it enmeshing with? And I said that also, it's paradoxical nature. So it's not only enmeshes with the negative, or the hate, or the anger, or the rage, it enmeshes with our love for our mother, for our motherland, for, you know, and it stokes up fears in connection, whether it's of, you know, saving the honor or, you know, because of partition, there are also a lot of fears of dismemberment. So that is absolutely sort of right on the head to say that, yes, there are aspects within each of us and which we do see. As I said, in intimate relations where we want 100% agreement and it evokes such a sort of anger and rage. Or every day we read incidents of over some totally trivial thing evoking such anger.
So from a very basic reading of Freud, which I have done, and that's where this question is coming from, and please correct me if I'm going wrong somewhere. So from the discussion so far, I feel that we are going into the questions of development of masculinities and reaching there by way of looking at the Freudian categories of when he talks about child-mother and mother-child relationship as the child grows in the initial years. So when we do a feminist reading of Freud, especially Nancy Chodorov, Therein she talks about the difference between the mother, the role of the mother in birthing and the role of the mother in rearing the child. In the second aspect, it is not necessary that the mother be the one who rears the child for the child to develop into a stable personality. It's the nature of the relationship, whether it is stable or not, irrespective of with whom the child has it, is what matters. So, do you think, now culturally we know that we look upon the mother as the one who needs to be there, and a lot of guilt is played on by our cultures and by the mothers themselves when they are absent in these roles. Do you think that bringing about a change in this aspect of the family and rearing of the child culturally, not of course it cannot happen overnight, but if we move towards that direction, what kind of changes do you think it'll bring about in the development of masculinities and hence in this antagonism in the other, which can be anyone, and in this respect the community and other community?
Yeah, I agree with it. That is why I have tried to place the factors in the what I understand of a North Indian upbringing of a male child. And to put Freud also in the own context, Freud, there was a very woman psychologist in US, when I'm saying about being able to tolerate difference, she said how difficult it is to tolerate difference. Look at Freud, he couldn't tolerate the difference that women are different. A lot of Freud's writing is actually bordering on misogynist, you know. So I'm saying, so to put Freud in that place, and that of course, and also psychoanalysis does the same thing. In a way, it's like blaming the mother. That whether if the son does something, like in a way placing, so if we could, definitely if there could be different kinds of, if you're interested, I can, I had written something on child upbringing and culture at the time of that incident. If you remember, there were an Indian couple with two children in Norway. And those children were taken away by the Norwegian welfare agency. At that time, there were protests outside the embassy, including friends of mine who were sending me messages to come. And the whole thing was posited, us warm Indians, these cold Norwegians, and they had such respect for those children, they never disclosed the real reasons because of the privacy of the children. Only because the husband and wife problem surfaced in India, and when it came to court and custody of child, then it surfaced how it all went. So yes, there are certain things which a child upbringing needs, a certain minimal, but the rest of the things, different cultures negotiated differently, and definitely a change in many of these would definitely have an impact. And so I have just tried to see a small portion of it, and also because this is the psychological method is always to do also see yourself. As you may notice, I have said only about boys' upbringing. I have little idea of girls' upbringing. So I'm saying so it is confined to that and confined more or less to the culture I have grown up in. So I'm sure more practices, if we can bring up, as long as the minimal needs, what a child needs, that is satisfied different, there are different ways of bringing up a child. In fact, I'm reminded of a book, it is written by Marge Piercy called Woman on the Edge of Time, I think long back, where she visualizes that each child will have three parents rather than two. And I think for the first time in UK, this has been recognized, I think it has to do with surrogacy. That, so I'm saying, that way possibilities abound.
So you were talking about how tolerance is difficult. And this intensification of intolerance is what leads to fascism, right?
That it enmeshes with it.
Yeah, so, can too much tolerance also lead to fascism? Because Zizek writes about, in the context of Nazi Germany, writes about how an image of Jew is created because of too much of tolerance, where the Jews he says that the Jews have created, the propaganda was such that the Jews had created such an image of themselves that they'd become a very important and adapt, they've adapted to the German society. And it's because of that they're going to tear it from inside. So doesn't, would too much tolerance in itself lead to fascism?
I couldn't follow. Who's being too tolerant in this?
So it's basically the Jews adapting to the German society so that there's an increasing tolerance among the Germans.
Hmm.
But this increasing tolerance itself, he says that there might be a creation of an illusion that that the Jews are creating an illusion that they're tolerable, but in actuality they're going to tear the society from inside out.
Hmm. This actually touches upon two things. One is that many of our fears, even as an individual, or our inner fears, many times when we feel, say, persecuted or humiliated or attacked. The second really important thing which it touches, which is another area which I am very keen to explore, it's called the narcissism of minor differences. Now, this was a phrase coined by Freud, but he never developed it further. What we see in this is that communities, as you are saying, which are very similar. You know, Gujarati Muslims, and they speak Gujarati, they'll say, Kanti Bhai came and, you know, killed us. Or when we see Tutus, Hutsis, like many times outsiders cannot even recognize that there's a difference. Now, one would think that violence would be easier, more virulent against, say, somebody Martian, who's like totally alien. But the peculiar thing is that when there is violence between communities which are very similar, it definitely seems worse, you know? So this whole thing that when communities are really similar, why is, so he used this term narcissism of minor differences, that when the difference is minor, when violence occurred, it seems much more sort of virulent in a way. Now, I can only correlate it to fears. See, when you're a minority, I think the fear is always of being absorbed and homogenized. You know, that is one of the fears which I can see working in this. But again, these are all areas which I would be very keen if a university like this or anywhere else could explore this, you know, narcissism of minor differences. And as I said, it also plays a role in intimate relations. When I said about the fascist within us, which wants our partner to 100% agree, it is also that you may agree about 95% things, and that little difference, why does it trigger? And I see its application across the board. When we see the whole of the Naxalite movement in India, and when we see splits, the minute there is a split, there may be some 98% opposition to capitalism, and the 2% difference evokes such murderous rage that people kill each other. So, I mean, these are all areas. I have interviewed two people in this regard because of my own interest in it. But I feel these, for me at least, form fascinating areas to explore, that why does it happen, this narcissism of minor differences, you know?
Policies, but love to differ with one another so much. Absolute in love with one another.
So I have two simple questions here on the left, right. First is when you mentioned about the incident, how the historical incident is used for justifying the violence, you gave an example of Somnath. So I see that this is happening in our country on both the sides. So I think this is just a description of what is happening, but what would be the solution? You cannot provide therapy to everyone, and you see a lot of people having information, false information from social media about wrong facts and all about these kind of things. So how will you talk to them? And second question is, when you talked about Savarkar and you said that although he was an atheist, he used his religion as an instrument. So some people differ and say that you can say this, but you will also have to look upon his definition of Hinduism and what reforms he did when he was abolishing untouchability and he was inclusive and all. So you should pay more attention towards that rather than labeling him to that particular fascism thing. So what's your take on that?
One thing is then this sort of formula of using a chosen trauma from history. Now, this is again the work of this Vulcan. Now, I think one process which is that if we look at it in psychoanalytical terms, it's called healthy mourning. Like even about partition, people feel that there has no been, like you have that Holocaust museum, that there, many people have suggested there be a museum here. That I think part of it is that that particular trauma, in a way, there has been no healthy mourning of it, you know, of the hurts. And then that, when there is no, so that failure to mourn of that hurt and that loss, that it leads that you are entitled to some revenge, you know. And then, I don't know what happens is, like when we were discussing this group behavior, that, see, you often see children, suppose a child is at a thumb-sucking stage, then has got over it, then is in some distress, will go back to thumb-sucking. So one of the unconscious defenses is called regression, where you regress to an earlier stage. So it feels that there is a kind of collective regression, where again, that split between good and bad. So my parents are good, enemies are all bad. There is actually no room for ambivalence at all, or of shades of gray, everything is like that. So, and the fifth element which he says is humiliation. And I think there is some strong thing that it is, you feel ashamed. Now how it enmeshes here when you're saying. So it, how we see it, it'll be that you are ashamed. Like Babri Masjid is like a symbol, like a phallic symbol of having conquered your motherland. So, and so you are ashamed of it, that this is what happened. And therefore, as a virile son of Mother India, you must demolish it. So it works in these ways, but one thing is this, I feel that there is something here. See, even when we suffer loss of a loved one who passes away, there's something called healthy mourning. Many times, and that healthy mourning is necessary, that is why it's called healthy. Otherwise, they say you go into, say, melancholia, which is different from mourning. So similarly, like partition, that these events, there is, I think, a lot of residue of this, you know, failure to mourn the loss, and therefore, and of shame. Now, these are all actually really speculative areas. We need really far more work, and I find that even really interdisciplinary universities, they hardly seem to have psychology. Like JNU has no interdisciplinary interface with psychology, you know. And so this whole area of social phenomena, I feel that a psychoanalytical viewpoint can offer us an angle of viewing, and which may be possibly of some assistance in this. The second thing which I just wanted to add was that many people also consider Jinnah to be an instrumentalist, that he also used religion as an instrument. And Ashish Nandi is one of them, he writes extremely well. He feels such people are more dangerous than people who have faith. He feels people who use religion as an instrument are more dangerous. Second, Savarkar is the only one. India has always been referred to as motherland, and he referred to India as fatherland. I think the only other country, I mean, these are all things which we don't know about. Russia is, I think, referred to as fatherland. Is it? No, motherland. Germany, probably. No. So otherwise, we generally, so I don't know how it went or what his view was, but he definitely had an. There are three, four people who, for people interested in this area. One is Sudhir Kakkar, the other is Ashish Nandi. So he feels many times that this admiration for European nationalism and that this feeling it's weakening Hindu race, that behind it is like a contempt that, okay, Hindus are so weak, they get conquered, you know. So it may be this thing, that feeling of we must be, you know, virile, brave. And so I feel all these are things which are worth exploring and can offer us insights into, you know, devising some strategies. I could only think of this of some sort of, you know, collective taking back of our projected bad parts, you know, which happens in individual therapy. Now, how it is to happen at a collective level is an area which we can explore.
This book that you are referring to,
which one? No, I don't have the reference right off.
Okay. But what is the...
His name is Vamik Vulcan.
Vamik
Vulcan. He's a sort of a Hungarian psychoanalyst. He's worked in most conflict areas. And I find him really, this I picked up because the lecture when I heard this.
You have to help me with the spelling.
V-A-M-I.
V-A-M-I.
K.
K.
Volkan. V-O-L.
V-O-L.
K-A-N. Because I thought it's happening in India, but when he gave this example that how it's like a formula. Pick up a chosen trauma from history, see as if it happened today, use it as if it happened today, conflate the people who were there with present day community. And so it's a formula which works, it seems, you know. So it's not only in India, it works. The other illustration is given of Serbia and Croatia, but I'm sure in other places. And I'm sure this sense of humiliation played a great part in Germany as well. I'm not familiar with history, so I don't know the sense of humiliation which the Germans had before the 90s, 20s, and 30s. Maybe people who are historians here will be able to tell us, but that they does seem to play a role, this sense of humiliation, you know. No, unfortunately, this is another area, but today we cannot go. There has been such mutual suspicion, the only between movement for social change and psychoanalysis. Psychoanalysis, accurately, has been mostly looked upon as status quoist. Don't change the world, adjust to the world. The only positive thing which psychoanalysis has, that almost no authoritarian regime has liked it. Freud, all the psychoanalysts had to flee from Germany. In USSR, the whole psychoanalytic movement collapsed. It's only after the breakup of USSR the psychoanalytical society has started. So I do not know the reasons, but it speaks well of psychoanalysis that no authoritarian regime seems to like psychoanalysis. So because of this suspicion, what happened was Freud himself confined himself more, except for stray references in Civilization and all. Then I think there was so much of anti-communism and McCarthyism going on in US. And so the whole psychoanalytical took totally an individual turn and remained confined. And as far as I know, even in India, I mean, I come from movement for social change. Almost all my adult life since as a student, I've engaged with movements for social change, you know. So you won't find any overlap. Indian psychoanalytical society was formed here in 1925, much before European nations. They are in Kolkata, very much the center of left movement. There is no interaction between the Indian Psychoanalytical Society or psychoanalysts in the left movement. So I think this mutual, there has been no, so to say, attempt at seeing this thing of whether it can have an application for movement for social change. And that is my own interest also when I said about narcissism of minor differences. Because this has, I mean, the left movement has paid such a price for this, you know. And not being able to see one's own drives towards power and dominance. It's like power corrupts. But not me. That has, seems to have been. So we are not able to see it within ourselves.
Thank you, Dr. Shukla. So I'm just adding on some closing comments to today's section. So we are all here in the university to step out from here as practitioners, most of us, but I think one thing of importance in practice is that of theory. Theory, concepts, ideas, what do they mean? Like sir today brought in a lot of categories formulated by Freud and how these are being used by him to understand incidences of communalism or riots or the othering. Looking at questions of nationalism, the way it is being talked about in at least let's say in India. So these categories, theoretical concepts, do help us understand the larger processes. And there are different ways of coming to it. So today we saw how psychoanalysis, at least in this small space, would look at it. Historically, there are ways of understanding how notions of what is Indian bend exactly, what were our relationships with the Arabs and communities from Central Asia who would invade every now and then in the northern belt of country, and how did that relationship over a period of time went over a change, and how it was projected to us by the Britishers when they stepped in. So there is a historical way of looking at it. Then Marx will have a grand theory of talking about how capitalism steps into this. Feminists will have a different take on Freud and Lacan. So the what I am trying to say is that theoretically you can approach at the same question from different disciplinary outlooks, and that is important to keep in mind when we try to find answers to these questions. Maybe looking at only what psychoanalysis says may give us an incomplete answer, but trying to look at what other forces have been at play make us realize that the picture is much more bigger, and that it is, even if we can't do anything about it, it is important to acknowledge that it exists. So because I'm in my third semester, I'm saying all these things, and once you also progress in this course and try and engage with the theoretical concepts that we do in our classrooms, it'll help if we do engage with the importance of theory and concept with practice, which sir has been doing and which we have seen today. So thank you, sir. And thank you, everyone.